realize that we live in an age when nobody is supposed to watch a film entirely. Apparently, it's not, because we don't have intermissions and Coke is not sponsoring this. But I hope you did enjoy the few glimpses of the 1954 film that Naveen Thomas was one of the artists who was exhibiting at the curation of the 5 days had suggested that we look at. Many people often ask us why we talk so much about films when we're supposed to be working on the internet. Surely there must be no relationship between the two. But for those of you who were present for Vibodh Parthasarathi's talk yesterday, we realized that cultural production and technologies are a part of an extremely large ecosystem of different kinds of production and so on and so forth. And today we are in fact going to talk a lot about films, images, archiving and so on and so forth. Maybe two references to put forward in terms of why we want to look at this particular film. Perhaps first is that Lev Menovich, who is a film and technology historian, in this incredible essay called The Database as a Symbolic Form, had talked about how one of the first ruptures that the digital offers is actually to the condition of the narrative, right? Like narrative as in storytelling, storytelling as in cause and effect and how one thing follows the other. That digital objects actually offer a certain kind of database logic where we are no longer talking about this happened and this happened and hence this happened, but actually talking about linearity, about different indexes just coming together and simulating narrative conditions for us. Maybe another way of why we need to look at films is because Jacques Derrida, in this seminal work called The Archive Fever, had talked about how archiving has become an inescapable condition of our times. And it's possibly something that all of us relate to, given how much archiving we do and how much everybody has become an archivist of some sort. So those are only two of the logics why we should be looking at films. And hopefully Lawrence will actually give us a more historical and a more fantastic understanding of what 21st century cinema can look like and how do we build archives for it. But before I hand over to him, it is my pleasure to officially welcome you to the second day of celebrating CIS's 5 years of existence. After the biblical downpour yesterday, we were a little scared that this might be an act of God which is asking us to shut us down. But thankfully today is a nice, sultry Bangalore day and we have the pleasure of listening to Lawrence Liang. I hope you had time to look at the different visualizations and infographics and the posters and installations that we have created to make our work slightly more accessible than it normally is. And when you are looking at it, you might realize that while we have shown you a lot of what we do, there is something important that's missing. And we realized that only yesterday when the first people came in, they had a look around and then they cornered me and then somebody said, "Ye sab to theek hai, but what is CIS?" Right? All this is fine, but what exactly is CIS? And we realized that we haven't really answered that question. Probably because we've spent 5 years trying to figure it out. And it is a conversation that I want to go back to, which happened about 5 years ago with a 4-member core team sitting around a table asking exactly that, saying what is it that we're going to do if we start something called Center for Internet and Society. I remember Sunil Abraham at that point sitting on the table, playing his card of the son of a preacher man, and talking about how what it means to grow up in the 90s in India, looking at different kinds of inequities, different kinds of injustices, different kinds of things which are going wrong, and how the encounter with the digital for the first time helped him understand about how he doesn't only have to be a witness to things which are going wrong, but actually can become an agent of change. That he, trained as an engineer, could actually look at the social possibilities of digital technologies. And at that point, he was talking about how, and by that time, he had of course already become an Ashoka Changemaker Fellow. He had worked with the United Nations Development Program. He'd worked with the IDRC. And he was just telling us that if I could do it, surely other people could do it. That there's a certain way by which digital technologies can empower. And that's what I want to do. I also remember Nirmita Narasimhan, who is visually challenged herself, sitting across the table from me and talking about what it means at a very personal level to grow up in a country which does not have infrastructure for blind people to read, to write, to study and to get an education. Nirmita talked about the amount of effort and support that she needed from families and friends and institutions and how it was never enough. And Nirmita now has a PhD and we are very, very proud of it. And maybe that's what CIS needs to do. Pranesh Prakash, who was a young law graduate from the National Law School at that time, who had just completed his internship with Lawrence, in fact, at the Alternative Law Forum, was telling us about how he was convinced that the law cannot simply be an instrument of control. that the law is not something that we just need to defend, but the law is something that we need to write. And that there is power in digital technologies and the communities that it brings with it to actually question and contest laws and policies, regulations, which we find are problematic. And then there was me. I was just doing my PhD in cyberculture, and I was very fascinated with lolcats. And I was basically looking for something which can help me make a career out of watching videos on YouTube. More or less that. So the four of us were sitting across the table and trying to answer that one question about what exactly is it that CIS is going to be? And I don't think we have answered it. But we have answered something else, which is what is the kind of thing that CIS wants to be? And I think the 5 years of work has been a glimpse of why CIS very crucially feels that digital technologies, especially internet technologies, are transforming the ways in which we think about being human, being social, and being political. So if anyone were to put a gun to my head and ask me what exactly is CIS, we basically say we are a research machine that really believes in fighting. And a lot of our work is about fighting against things that we find wrong around us. And as you will see from not just the work which has happened in the last 5 years, but also the new teams which have emerged. So if you look at the Access to Knowledge team, which is trying to look at how significantly education and learning systems within the Indian language and higher education can be transformed by using Wikipedia as a platform. If you look at the ways in which the privacy people, who are going to do an incredible exhibition for us tomorrow, showing us videos and why we should be concerned about privacy, which is still not dead, despite what the UID people might be telling you, right? There are all these different fights and battles that we fight, and we are very, very happy that all of you have joined us. It could not have happened without the support of an incredible, incredibly generous network of institutions and people and places and resources. And one of them is actually Lawrence Liang, who is an institution, a person, probably a resource, and a people. I was just trying to kind of put up a Facebook status update today talking about why you should be coming to CIS today. And I think there are two reasons. One is that all of us know that when Lawrence Liang speaks, the world stops spinning for a bit. And if you want to experience that, you need to be here. And the second is that if you don't know Lawrence Liang, and I don't know how to complete that sentence because I don't think it's possible for you not to know Lawrence Liang. I have traveled a lot in the last 6 years, and I have begun most of my introductions lately by saying, hi, my name is Nishant, I work with CIS, I am in Bangalore, and yes, I know Lawrence Liang. Which kind of, you know, is the FAQ that kind of gets over with it. That should do it. But I just want to briefly mention that it has been a pleasure working with Lawrence. He's also a member of the board at CIS. And 2 years ago, for a collection we published called CPOV, which is Critical Point of View, an edition which looks at the Wikipedia book project really, really critically from different disciplines, Lawrence has a fantastic essay called A Brief History of the Internet in the 13th and 14th Century. Mm-hmm. There are free copies available in the office if you want to grab it, or on our website. And from the 13th and the 14th century, Lawrence is now going to take us to the 21st century and talk about what does it mean maybe to be a pervert, maybe to be a pirate, maybe to be somebody who steals and creates archives of knowledges, and in this case, cinema. So Lawrence, we're all yours.
Thanks, Ajahn. I think that's the politest way that anyone has told me that I speak too fast, that the world stops. So if the world stops at any point of time, just let me know. So it's great to be here at CIS celebrating the 5th anniversary. There's an episode in a British TV serial which I enjoy greatly called Goodness Gracious Me. And there's one particular, you know, moment which I want to actually talk about. There's a Gujarati couple and they're having a big argument because the father is extremely disappointed, and he points out to the television and he tells his wife, you know, look at that young man and see what he's achieved. You know, at such a young age, he's just like 23 and he's the captain of the English team. He's so good looking. He has so much money. He's married to one of these Spice Girls, etc. And look at our son, you know, completely useless. So the mother, you know, sheepishly says, you know, but you have to understand, I mean, he has a PhD in maths. He started a .com and, you know, he's just about the second or the third richest man in England. So it's not too bad. He says, yeah, but that's nothing. I mean, look at this guy. And then he turns around to the son and says, you know, you useless fellow. And there in the corner is the 5-year-old kid. So in some ways, CIS, a 5-year-old organization, is like this hyper overachieving, you know, NRI child, right? So in 5 years, and with really a core team of like maybe 5 or 6 people, it's quite amazing the amount that they've achieved. But what I want to do today is I want to link this idea of 5 years, 5 years of an institution that works primarily with technologies of the 21st century and works with the idea of the digital futures that we kind of have a glimpse of, and contrast that with another significant date of 2013, which a number of you must have heard about, read about in recent times, which is 100 years of Indian cinema. And I'm interested in looking at how these two speak to each other. How does 100 years of Indian cinema, with its kind of grand legacy in terms of, you know, huge amounts of films, largest film producing country in the world, etc., speak to the future in terms of the internet? And I want to do this by looking really closely at the idea of what it may mean to imagine an encyclopedia of the second century of Indian cinema. And I'll come to why that is an important thing. But this idea of contrasting 100-year-old technology in the Indian context along with the internet is also a way of thinking about how we use terms like old and new media. You know, I mean, these are terms that have been in fashion for a while, but they're not very useful. I'm instead more interested in thinking about how it may be more useful to think about what it means to grow young and old simultaneously. Friedrich Nietzsche has a concept of what he describes as the untimely. The untimely for him is that if one were to try to imagine a historical project and imagine what it would mean to actually trace out a history, the usual route is to trace out a teleological route starting from origins to the present. And his argument or his question is, what does it mean to inhabit a moment at its point of becoming rather than the point where it has become? Right? What is this? What does it mean, in other words, when we think about the histories of technology, to inhabit them as though they were simultaneously growing young and old? Because one of the key things that cinema teaches us is that cinema as a technology is both simultaneously historical, in that one can speak, for example, as we've seen in the previous film, about an old film as a certain kind of an artifact of time, an artifact of a certain kind of technology, an artifact of social and cultural politics, etc. But it is also simultaneously something that's constantly growing. So if you were to contrast the film that you saw with, let's say, you know, a 3D movie that you see now, there is a way in which both of these occupy something called cinema, even as they are both simultaneously growing old and young. And I'm going to stick to this idea of growing old and young to imagine the realm of this future of the image, as well as the past of the image, simultaneously kind of taking place. And what is the space that they can actually occupy? And I'll posit that the encyclopedia, not as, you know, an object, but as a phenomenon, as a conceptual device, as a useful way of thinking about how cinema can grow young and old simultaneously. When I think about encyclopedias, immediately what kind of comes to my mind is really this memory of being in school, where unfortunately, or fortunately, or unfortunately, a lot of the teachers that we had to supplement their income were also encyclopedia salesmen, right? And they would go around from students to students' house selling the Encyclopedia Britannica. And for some strange reason, it was always an interesting coincidence that the people who could afford to buy the Encyclopedia Britannica were also the ones who did very well in that particular exam. But for a large number of the students in my school who couldn't afford the Encyclopedia Britannica, it was almost as though the encyclopedia was just out of your reach. And the encyclopedia being out of your reach was somehow linked to the world being out of your reach. There was some way in which you couldn't grasp the world because you couldn't grasp the encyclopedia. Now, this kind of fact of, you know, the encyclopedia being out of your reach, or as a certain kind of expression of a lack or a desire of a certain kind, haunted much of the ways that we thought about encyclopedias. And I would constantly fantasize about what I would do if I had the Encyclopedia Britannica at home. And most of my fantasies entail the idea of reading it from page, you know, from cover to cover. I would start at A and end with Z, and in that way, know everything that there was to know about the world. I mean, this is a fantasy which, of course, is concomitant with the larger fantasy of the encyclopedia as a project itself. The encyclopedia was born in the era of the Enlightenment. It was very much a part of this idea of what it meant to be modern, to be able to encapsulate all the knowledge of the world in one place. Even if my fantasies didn't entirely come true, for the Encyclopedia Britannica, they came partially true in 1994, when Ashish Rajadaksha and Paul Willimon brought out the Encyclopedia of Indian Cinema. This was a much more manageable project. This was a project that it literally bursts onto the scene in terms of any cinephile in India will recall that moment. I mean, it's that question, what were you doing on 9/11? For a cinephile in India, it was, what were you doing when the Encyclopedia of Indian Cinema came out? Because that was an encyclopedia which I literally read from cover to cover. But it was a very strange experience. Because most of the films that the encyclopedia talked about, I'd never seen. They were completely fictitious projects. So you read about Alamara, you read about Raja Harishchandra, you read about Zubeda, you read about Sitara Devi, but these were names very often without a moving image. And that for me was a paradox. But it wasn't an entirely strange paradox, because in many ways, before the advent of the ease with which we now access the moving image, a lot of our entry points as cinephiles into the world of cinema was marked as a textual experience. I remember very clearly knowing everything there was to know about Citizen Kane much before I had seen Citizen Kane. We had participated in a number of quizzes in which we knew all the trivia, Rose Bird to, you know, the invention of the deep shot, deep focus, and of course Casablanca. We would easily tell you that, the mistake in Casablanca is everyone assumes that he says, play it against Sam. He never says, play it against Sam. He says, you played it for her, you played for me. Play as time goes by. You knew all of this much before you actually saw the film. So in fact, when I actually saw Casablanca, I was deeply disappointed because it was such a brief moment. This was a moment that I had spent hours fantasizing about. It surely had to last a little longer in my own kind of, you know, affective, intimate memory, but it just glimpsed and ran by you. But this paradox of the missing image as a way in which you can think about a parallel to the world that is somehow just out of your reach. Somehow the image is not available to you. Now you cut just from the late 90s to the early 2000s, and you have a scenario where most of us sitting here have multiple hard drives on which we have thousands and thousands of films which we don't have the time to watch. But we do sit and classify them very lovingly. So we classify our different hard drives. Some people do it according to chronology, some people do it according to genre, some people do it alphabetically. Whole range of taxonomies that we invest in the making of our lists and of our libraries. So this dual impulse between, on the one hand, a world that is constantly out of your reach, and the desire to create a taxonomy and an order of knowing that makes the world intelligible to you, is really at the heart of the encyclopedic imagination. And my talk today is called Slouching Towards Tillon. And I take the title of my talk from my favorite writer, the Argentinian writer-philosopher Jorge Luis Borges. Borges, as it turns out, many years later, shared this fantasy of mine. And he had a fantasy exactly of the same nature of wanting to read an encyclopedia cover to cover. And he would accompany his father to the National Library, and being too shy to actually explore, he would just pick out the closest copy that he had. So he tells us in an essay that he writes about, you know, the history of his reading, that it happened to be B. And so he says in that way, he learned about Druids, Druses, and Dryden, right? Things which are seemingly unconnected to each other and have no way in which they relate to each other except on the pages of the encyclopedia. Borges' story, Tillon, Uppar, Orbis, Tertius, is the inspiration of my talk, and I'll come in great detail about this. But Borges' world and his entire universe is one that is populated by fantastical creatures, creatures that, in a way, kind of, you know, break the rules of certain kind of, you know, human-animal relationships. He has an endless series of mirrors and labyrinths, and at the end or in the middle of all of this is the idea for him of the project of the library and that of the encyclopedia. So Borges once said that when I think of paradise, I think of it in terms of a library. Now this library that Borges had, the most famous version of which was something called the Library of Babel. The Library of Babel was imagined as an infinite library. And a number of architects and artists have attempted to visualize and have failed to visualize the idea of the Library of Babel. Because the Library of Babel is what we would recognize and call the internet. The infinite library from which one can draw infinite resources, but one is always under the danger of getting lost in. So I want to think about this idea of what it means to think of this convergence in a way at this point of time between the idea of film cultures and information cultures. The ways that we inhabit the world of cinema now is increasingly by ways of bits and bytes. One of the greatest kind of new pastimes, and we need a word for it, we need to invent a new word for it, is what I would describe as torrent watching, right? When you put on a torrent and you wait for it to download and you look at 72% completed or 17 minutes, 45, or heartbreakingly in some cases where there are only one-seaters, 18 days, 22 hours, right? And the idea of the ting that happens, the new production of this kind of epiphanic joy on hearing the completion of a torrent, because we know that after that our machine will watch the film for us or that our iPads will read the book for us. The point is not about reading or writing any longer. The point is about collecting. But what are we to make of all of this endless kind of, you know, act? And it's hard work. I know with the thousands of books that my computer is reading and with the thousands of films that it's watching that it's a lot of work. So the question that I really want to raise is, how do we convert some of this personal affective labor into a kind of a larger project? Encyclopedias have always, in a way, existed at this cusp of a certain kind of an experience of finitude and infinity, right? They're both markers of our finitude, because you will never be able to complete the Encyclopedia Britannica from A to Z, even as they signal a certain kind of an infinity. But how do we think about the worlds that are created when we encounter Druids, Druzans, and Dryden in these worlds? For Borges, the encyclopedia is not merely a representation space of the world. In other words, it's not that compendium of facts about the world. It is, for Borges, the active invention and creation of different kinds of worlds. This is not working for some reason. Yeah. So I talked about the Encyclopedia of Indian Cinema and what it did. Now, one of the great or the remarkable things about the Encyclopedia of Indian Cinema is that if you were to think about it as a project, when you think of an encyclopedia, you normally think of it as a place where you refer to facts. But what kind of facts are you speaking about when you're speaking about film history? 90% of the films pre-1950 in India do not exist. 95% of the films before the 1930s do not exist. So what kind of a film history are we speaking about? We don't have the moving image. What you have instead are a bunch of either records, you have them either in government files, or you have them in the form of trade journals, you have them in the form of magazines. What kind of a task does it require to reconstruct, in a way, this history? Is it a factual project, or is it a speculative project? Ashish Rajadaksha, in his preface to the Encyclopedia of Indian Cinema, says that the approach that they took, the methodology that they had, is what he describes as the most likely theory. This is in the absence of absolutely verifiable records, and in the presence of very kind of competing claims, you have, for example, multiple versions of the same film. You have records of artists who've been in films, but then you don't find them in the film. So where did they disappear? What is this world that they've kind of evaporated into? And I had an experience of this when while working on my own book, which is on law, justice, and cinema in India, and I was at the OCEAN archive, because they have the greatest collection of publicity material. And I scanned through the archive looking for films which were about the courtroom. And I found a number of films. I found like at least 20 films about the courtroom from the 50s, which I had never heard of. And I'd never encountered in an encyclopedia, etc. So I was wondering where this missing gap was coming from. So I spoke to the archivist there. And I said, you know, tell me about these films. Are they available? Who made them? Where can I find more information about them? And he told me something very interesting. He said, these films were never made because they were only made for tax purposes, right? So you had the muhurat, you had the publicity material that was shown, and the film was never made, but it was shown as a massive loss so that you could claim tax relief. So you have, in other words, this entire world of the fictive film that exists in the real archive. Now this kind of unholy intermingling of the real, the fictive, the virtual, the present, etc. All of these for me actually help us think about what the project of the encyclopedia might be. Because if you were to take Borges in one of the most delightful accounts of an encyclopedia, he speaks about a Chinese encyclopedia called The Celestial Empire of Benevolent Knowledge. And in The Celestial Empire of Benevolent Knowledge, he tells us that animals are classified in the following way. A, belonging to the emperor. B, embalmed. C, tame. D, sucking pigs. E, sirens. F, fabulous. G, stray dogs. H, included in the present classification. I, frenzied. J, innumerable. K, drawn with a very fine camel hairbrush. L, etc. M, having just broken the water pitcher. And N, that which from a long way looks like flies. Marveling at this delightful taxonomy, Foucault says that the monstrous quality that runs through Borges's enumeration consists not of the mixing of unlikely animals, but in the fact that the common grounds on which their meeting is possible itself has been destroyed. What is impossible is not the propinquity of things, but instead the very site on which this propinquity is possible. The animals, I, frenzied, J, innumerable, K, drawn with a very fine camel hairbrush. Where could they ever meet except in the immaterial sound of the voice pronouncing the enumeration or on the pages transcribing it? Where else could they be juxtaposed except in the non-place of language? For Borges, the Chinese encyclopedia is bewildering and disturbing in its capacity to challenge us to think the world in terms of this. So it's almost a kind of a self-recurring loop. And in his fiction, Borges constantly pushes the question of the relationship between the stabilization of the world through taxonomy and the destabilization of the world through taxonomy. In other words, even as you create a taxonomy to create a stable world, you also at the same time erupt or create a kind of an eruption of instabilities. Now, one of the most powerful glimpses of such an alternative world is found in Borges' story, Tilon, Ukbar, Orbis, Tertius. The story begins with a conversation between Borges and his very close friend, Adolfo Bio Casares. And they're speaking, and then Casares mentions a phrase. And the phrase is, mirrors and copulation are abominable since they both multiply the numbers of men. Borges is very impressed, proto-feminist, very impressed with this line. So he asks Casares, you know, where he got this line from. And Casares refers him to an encyclopedic article on Ukbar in the Anglo-American Cyclopedia, described as a literal, if inadequate, reprint of the Encyclopedia Britannica of 1902. Now, Borges happens to have a copy of this encyclopedia at home. So they bring out the encyclopedia to look for the entry on Ukbar. And it turns out that there is no entry on Ukbar. So Borges says, you must be mistaken because, you know, it's not in my encyclopedia. But Casares is absolutely sure that he read this line in the entry on Ukbar in the encyclopedia. So he goes home and he checks up his encyclopedia and finds that Ukbar is there. So they go to other encyclopedias of the same edition, but they find that Ukbar is not there. And sometimes it's there. So Ukbar, it turns out, exists only in a few copies of this encyclopedia. Now, as the story proceeds, it's revealed that this mysterious country called Ukbar, lying in an obscure region of Asia Minor, turns out actually to be part of an intellectual project of imagining and creating an imaginary world called Tilon. The narrator learns that Tilon is a conspiracy or an intellectual kind of plan of a mysterious group, a secret society, which has a number of people as its members, including George Berkeley. And this society realized that to create an entire universe required the work and commitment of a large number of people, but it also required the creation of a mythology of the universe. And what greater mythology could you have if not the encyclopedia? So they decide that before they actually create Tilon, they will create the Encyclopedia of Tilon. So the Encyclopedia of Tilon has detailed entries about the various rules of physics, which are very different from the normal rules that we have on Earth. It has an entire history of religion in Tilon, etc. This marvelous big project. Ezra Buckley, The dissident in the group, who's an eccentric millionaire from Tennessee, scorns the modest scale of the sex ambition and instead proposes the invention of an entire planet, an entire universe, and an entire set of laws for this planet. And this is still on. But he only had one proviso. The proviso was that the whole scheme should have no truck with that imposter Jesus Christ. That was his only kind of, you know, the caveat that he had. So the task of the writing of the Encyclopedia of Talon begins in the course of time, and the encyclopedia then runs to 40 volumes. And then strange things begin to happen, where the imaginary objects from Talon start appearing in the real world. And they begin to manifest themselves in the real world slowly, taking over the real objects. Now, why do I use the idea of slouching towards Talon in thinking about the relationship between cinema and the internet? When Ashish's encyclopedia came out, and when I speak about the fact that this, for me, was the encyclopedia of Talon, it was an imaginary world with its imaginary mythology, because the real referent object did not exist. But over a period of time, the objects slowly begin to emerge in the world. Between 1994 to 2013, we've suddenly had a large number of the things that one saw only as still images finally emerging as movie images. Raja Harishchandra now is no longer just a part of a mythological universe, but it is not really a part of the real world either. It exists instead in the cusp between these two realms, between the known, the unknown, between the knowable and the unknowable. And for me, this is the domain in which I would imagine what the project of the task of building an encyclopedia might be. And I'm going to come to this, you know, a demonstration of something that we experimented. But one thing that I do want to mention is that just as the people who built the Encyclopedia of Talon recognize that the labors that go into the making of an encyclopedia is almost the same as the labors that go into the making of a universe, the labors that go into creating these infrastructures on the internet of the moving image are also of a similar kind. And unfortunately, on that count, we don't do too well as a country. Now, it's bad enough that we don't have a sense of our own kind of, you know, national history or national cultural legacy in terms of the preservation of films in a particular way. And I would highly recommend a recent film that came out and ran only for a week in Bangalore called Celluloid Man, which is about an amazing archivist, a legendary archivist, Nair, from the from the National Film Archive of India. But one of the amazing things that emerges in that film is precisely these kind of toss of the mad eccentric collectors, all of whom are saving cultures or bits of cultures literally at one point of time, reel by reel. But now the question would be, how does one do the same thing bit by bite? Right? This entire idea, on the one hand, the world is available to you, the images are available to you, and yet at the same time, it is equally a mythical, fictitious world, because somehow the image is just out of your reach. And the reason that it's out of your reach now is not because of the fact that it's not available, but because you now have new regimes of control, including copyright, that make it impossible for you to access the image. A large number of films in Hollywood... A large number of films in Hollywood, you take Vertigo, Mulholland Drive, all of them have at their narrative core the mysterious femme fatale, the blonde who can never be obtained. And for me, that's a very telling kind of a metaphor of the unobtainability of the image. Because if you were to think about how we transition from the history of cinema to the history of the internet, the encyclopedia that I'm going to show you, as well as the archive of Indian cinema that we've created that I'm going to show you, is equally a fictitious project, because you can't see much of what can be there. And the reason that you can't see it is because of, you know, these regimes of copyright, because technologically there's nothing preventing us from creating an entire encyclopedia of Indian cinema online. So this task of building these infrastructures is a very crucial one. And I would here distinguish between research and infrastructures of research. Infrastructures of research are normally associated with large projects, universities, science institutions, databases, archives. But the era of the internet has changed all of that. In the era of the do-it-yourself world, I would propose that we think of infrastructure as autonomous infrastructure. Autonomous infrastructures for me are infrastructures that are not dependent on monumental acts of invention, but on incremental acts of invention. And the incremental acts of invention really, in a way, contribute to the creation of infrastructures that are actually not possible if one were to think about them in terms of either the state or of corporations alone. The best example of that, of course, is Wikipedia. Wikipedia is a redefinition of the idea of the encyclopedia. It's not an online encyclopedia. It's a reconfiguration of relationships of knowledge. It's a reconfiguration of the ways that we think about who constitutes, you know, the arbiters, as it were, of knowledge. And this idea of the autonomous infrastructure is a very powerful one, because if you think about the greatest video archive in the world for video art, UbuWeb. UbuWeb boasts of having more video art on its archive than the Museum of Modern Art in New York. It's run by one person, through contributions by a range of people, volunteers. Run by one person. The greatest film archive in the world at the moment, Karagarga. Who owns Karagarga? Who runs Karagarga? No one knows. The greatest library, or the erstwhile greatest library of books in the world, library.nu. At one point of time, 1 million books on library.nu. Now here is the bad news. Largest number of users of library.nu from India. 10% of the 500,000 users of library.nu were from India. In other words, 50,000 active users of library.nu with 1 million books. Number of books contributed from India? 0.02%. So there's something strange here. There's something strange which we need to think about in terms of a much larger link of how we think about questions of public infrastructure. Because if public infrastructure is something that one has always left to the state or abandoned because of the state, how do we now think about our relationships to questions of cultural heritage as well as to the future of this cultural heritage in these days of autonomous infrastructure? How do we, in other words, gather together some kind of effort at creating the universe of Talon rather than waiting for it to be represented in an encyclopedia? I want to now just run you through a small demonstration of the Encyclopedia of Indian Cinema. There are two sites that I will show you. The first one is called, this is the cinemaofindia.org or wiki.indiancine.ma, and the other one is indiancine.ma, and I'll come to that. But what we did with the Encyclopedia of Indian Cinema online was we used Ashish Rajadaksha and Paul Willimon's encyclopedia as a base. Thankfully, they had retained their copyright in the Encyclopedia of Indian Cinema, which meant that we could take the entire base information and start from there in the creation of an online encyclopedia. And we've basically taken their entire thing but created a wiki structure, which means that anyone can now contribute, edit, add, etc. So if you go, there are different categories that you will find. You can also create new categories. And you'll find that there are a number of categories here which don't exist in the offline version. Those two women with their cigarettes there, incidentally, trivia. CIS will give you an Android phone if you're able to identify the two of them. Anyone? M.S. Subbalakshmi and Balasaraswati, picture from the 30s, right? So CIS is now obliged to give its executive director an Android phone, which means this fancy Samsung can come to us. So if you go to the Chronicle, you'll find that it replicates the structure of the encyclopedia. So the original encyclopedia had a Chronicle, you'll find the same, except that now, in this Chronicle, you are able to do a lot more because you're able to link material, you're able to link to resources on the web, you're able to insert moving images, you're able to insert archival material, a whole range of things that are possible. How can I have? if you go to writers and say you wanted to have a look at K. Abbas, then apart from the basic information about Abbas, everything else can also be interlinked from the as in any wiki structure. You can also see clips. This is from Abbas's South Hindustani, a remake of Seven Samurais, and also the debut film of Amitabh Bachchan, right? you'll also find a whole range of extra information, including links, for example, to external tributes, links to other archives, including an audio clip. So this is a tribute to Abbas in a website. This is archival material from newspapers about Abbas. And this is an audio interview of Abbas.
Khaja Ahmad Abbas is an eminent author in English and Urdu.
Abbas, of course, was one of the most important writers, film critics, filmmakers, and he was, amongst other things, he wrote, you know, the screenplay for most of Raj Kapoor's greatest films, including Avara, Sri 420, etc. You can go to Avara from Abbas's page, or you could, you know, go to Avara directly, or go via a search to Avara. But when you go to Avara, it's now possible to link to songs. Now, this is crucial for me because technology doesn't just change the way that films are seen. It also drastically changes the way that films are studied. For those of you familiar with the film studies tradition in India, one of the most painful aspects of film studies is this description of a scene, right? Because most of the times, the assumption was that you're reading a book or you're reading an article, and the moving image actually doesn't exist. So you'll find that film studies has in a way been shaped almost by the act of describing and analyzing textually that scene. Now that remains a certain kind of a tradition, but that's not the only one. Now the question for us is, what happens if you don't have to describe the scene any longer? What are the other ways in which you can write upon film and about film if you don't have to describe the scene? How do you think, in other words, of the possibilities of annotating a scene rather than describing it? What is the kind of information that one can read into the scene? Avara, because it was made in 1951, is out of copyright, so you don't have a problem. But very often, one of the big problems I have with the encyclopedia is every time I create a link to a song or to a scene on YouTube, 2 weeks later it's been removed because of copyright infringement, right? It's a major pain. There are also other interesting things about Avara that can be brought into it now. This is a Turkish program performing Avara, because to my mind, Avara was the most successful film in the world. Not the most successful Indian film in the world, the most successful film in the world in terms of the kind of impact that it had. There's a great story that I love of Nehru coming back from Russia after meeting Stalin, and he calls up Prithviraj Kapoor and he says, you know, what is this stupid movie that your son has made? That Stalin kept asking me about it and I had no idea what he was talking about. Right? So Avara had this incredible impact in all parts of the world. So the question is, what is the history of Indian cinema? Is the history of Indian cinema a national project? Or is it now possible, given the fact that a lot of these new information and material that is available around the world, that allows us to also reconstitute the object of our study? This, for example, is again a stage performance from 2011 from China.
Avara hu, meditation, ma'am.
And one of the reasons why we're able to do this is because the question of what is an archive, what is an encyclopedia, who is an archivist has changed entirely. And it's changed because the line between a professional archivist, an amateur cinephile, a researcher, or a scholar has changed because the tools of our trade have changed. All of us now go into archives with digital cameras, with handheld scanners, and even the act of collecting material, which would be seen as primary material in terms of your own research, becomes as it were a simultaneous act of the creation of an archive. So this line between the idea of what constitutes research and what constitutes the creation of an archive entirely changed. A couple of other things in the encyclopedia which is of interest. Unlike an encyclopedia of Indian cinema in terms of the print edition, which has not been updated since 1998, and this is a common problem, the difference between an Encyclopedia Britannica and a Wikipedia is the fact that Wikipedia is a live project. It's a project that's not dependent in a way on the whims and fancies of a single editorial board, but the fact that a large number of people are constantly adding to it. So you have a scenario in India where one of the missing big gaps in cinema history is the history of theaters and theatrical spaces. And since we're in Bangalore, I want to look, for example, at the story of Plaza Theater, which has not been told. One of the family members of the Plaza Theater is sitting there shamefaced because he has no idea of the history of the Plaza Theater. But the Plaza Theater has an amazing, amazing and fascinating history, started by someone called Arkot Narayan Swami Mudaliar, in terms of he was someone who became a contractor to the British government, etc. This is the original site of the Plaza Theater, where it was a furniture shop. And they were the purveyors, you know, to the crown. And I won't get into the detailed story, but it's a very dramatic story of heartbreak, loss, and invention, because one of the family members loses his wife, very unfortunately, sent by the family to recover his spirits to England, goes to England and falls in love with cinema, and comes back and recreates the Plaza and Piccadilly Circus in Bangalore. There are stories from interviews, there are stories from newspapers. This is a picture of the Maharaja Wodeyar. The longest running film in Plaza was The Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments basically changed the story of the theater itself, because after the war, the theater was going into a major decline, because since the main people who went to the theater were the British soldiers, after the war there were no patrons. But when The Ten Commandments came, all the Christian schools made it mandatory for the school children to go watch The Ten Commandments. And suddenly you had a revival of the spirits of Plaza. This is a picture of the family and various members of the family celebrating the fourth week of Plaza. There's an interview with one of the brothers who owned the Plaza. And then this is a sad bit. This is the bit when Plaza was demolished after it was acquired for the Bangalore Metro project. Another incredible story is that of Elgin Talkies. Elgin Talkies actually began in 1896, the year cinema was born. And they started showing films in the 1910s. Elgin Talkies closed down last year, but they have a notebook in Elgin which documents every single film that was shown in the theater from the 1910s till the 2000s, right? 100-year history, completely dilapidated. No one is really interested in this. So when I try to think about this project of the encyclopedia in a Borgesian sense of the term, this is that threshold world. This is that nebulous world between the real and the fictive. How does something pass on to history from the realms of fiction? How does it in a way body forth from the world of fiction into the domain of fact? Through acts of imagination, right? Now, I know that I'm going to be running out of time and I want time for questions, so I'll very quickly show you the IndianCine.ma. Please feel free to go back and browse it. The IndianCine.ma for us is our fictitious project. It's a fictitious project because it is a project that at one level demonstrates the possibilities of what can be done, even as it shows you what cannot be done. Because when you try to click on a number of the films, you'll find that you cannot watch them because of limitations that we have on. So it's you can browse either through language or through studios or through the year or through directors, actors, a whole range of ways you can view it in various kind of formats. So for example, if I wanted to see all the Bengali films, then it gives me a chronological account of all the Bengali films which are there. And if I say choose one film here, I can view it on different grids. First, I can view it according to the information page, and all the information is interlinked with each other. Or I can view it on a player view, where if the film is out of copyright, you'll be able to view the entire film and annotate the entire film. So you can do a mark-in point and a mark-out point and annotate the entire film. Or I can choose to view it according to a timeline, which gives you a snapshot of the entire film and a completely new way of looking at the aesthetics of cinema itself. Or I can choose to see it according to clips. And if I click on a particular clip, then it plays you a small 5-second fragment of that clip. If I double click on it, it takes you to that moment of the film, and you can choose to annotate that particular moment. Or I can even choose to see it according to a map, because it links to Google Maps. And then you can see all of the films, for example, that have been shot in Indiranagar. Or if you're interested in looking at mapping one particular film and the way that it moves, it'll take you to that particular film. You can sort by various things. You can sort, of course, by useful information, like title, director, country. Or you can go by pixels, by hue, by aspect ratio, by duration, resolution. At one level, this is a serious thing. At another level, it's a joke because we don't know what to do with it. Information technology allows us to view cinema both in terms of the classical way as, you know, kind of cultural objects, but also increasingly now as data and as sets of data. And what are we to make of all this data? We don't know yet. But these are the worlds that are waiting in a way to be created. You can choose to see movies which are with videos or without, and you can also see the encyclopedia of Indian cinema within indiancine.ma, where all of the films which are there in the encyclopedia of Indian cinema will be backed up by moving images. The indiancine.ma and the Encyclopedia of Indian Cinema project are sister projects of an online video archive that I'm a part of called PADMA, the Public Access Digital Media Archive. And our interest has really been in this question of how do we rethink the archive of the moving image? What is it that one can actually do in terms of a collaborative venture into the archive of the moving image? And it's in a way a small infrastructure that we've built recognizing the 100 years of Indian cinema, as well as recognizing the 5 years of the Center for Internet and Society, because it is a piece of infrastructure that's geared towards the future of Indian cinema in terms of the internet. What does it mean to actually think of the archive of Indian cinema on the internet? Every year from now, there will be a new decade in which copyright will cease. Copyright term in India is for 60 years. So at the moment, any film before 1952 is in the public domain. In other words, in the next 7 years, the entire 50s will come into the public domain, the golden era of Indian cinema. So you're talking about a very, very exciting period in which a whole range of possibilities can be enabled, even as one has to struggle to ensure that, unlike the US, where they have gone on the evergreening of copyright, that if copyright term extends by another 10 years, then it will not come out into the public domain, right? Which means that you've got to wait for another 10, possibly 20, 30 more years before these films come into the public domain. So let me, it's a vast archive, so I'll leave it for you to kind of explore the archive on your own. But let me kind of wrap up and link to some of the things that I've kind of spoken about. And I want to return to this idea that Ashish had when he started the Encyclopedia of Indian Cinema. And I want to read from the from the preface to the encyclopedia, where he says, attempts to locate individual films or filmmakers required constant cross-referencing between technological, economic, political, and cultural chronologies. Try to read any one of these series in terms of the intersections with all of the others. The task was made all the harder by the simple, frustrating fact that only a handful of India's silent films appear to have survived. And it's important to remember that there was a fire in 2003 at the FTII, which destroyed more than 500 pre-1950s Indian films, the only kind of prints that were there. The fact that only a handful of India's silent films appear to have survived, and that meant that many of the key sound films are not readily available for consultation. This has meant that we have had to rely on contemporary, whenever possible, or subsequent accounts, surviving publicity materials and so on, all of them deeply enmeshed in the rhetorical amalgam of discourses mentioned earlier. Consequently, when approaching a film, the discourses placing it would first have to be negotiated and placed in their turn. Of course, that way, madness lies as the critic historian is relentlessly driven further and further away from the object, the source, the film. But it is a madness that must be faced, even risked, within limits with which we have endeavored not to overstep. This idea of the madness, the necessary madness in a project like the Encyclopedia, whether it is Tillon, whether it is the Encyclopedia Britannica, whether it is Wikipedia, or it is a National Film Archive, they are brought together in a way by this idea of madness. And the greatest film archive in the world, in terms of celluloid film, is the Cinémathèque in Paris, which was created by Henri Langlois. Langlois, like us, discovered shockingly that 70% of early French cinema did not exist because of silver nitrate and the highly flammable nature of silver nitrate films. Most of them had burnt down. So he started an archive in which he basically begged, borrowed, stole films, and he would store it in his house. He ran out of space in his house, so he started putting it in his bathtub, sacrificing a bath for the preservation of films. When World War II happened, there was a danger that the Nazis would destroy his films. So he goes to all his friends' house, digs up their gardens, and puts in his films, his reels, into their garden. And after World War II, he brings it all out and starts the Cinémathèque. Now, the Cinémathèque has been the best school for the French New Wave. From Truffaut to Godard, from Agnès Varda, all of them, in a way, learned their cinema, not in a film school, but by watching films in a Cinémathèque. And for me, Henri Langlois is really an interesting character because of one thing that he said. He said the best way to preserve films is by showing them, right? So if the idea of the moving image is locked up either through law or through technology, that is not an archive. The archive of the second century of Indian cinema is one which will be built in a way through films that have been stolen, shared, illegally obtained, legally obtained, but all on the principle that they have to be seen. Because films, in Langlois's words, are like Persian carpets. They have to be walked on. So I'll stop there for now and open it out for any questions that you have, both about the cinema project, but also more generally about the relationship between the internet and cinema. Thank you.
I'm sure there are loads of questions, so can we begin who wants to push forth? I also understand Lawrence has an intimidating feeling where everybody gets bedazzled into silence. So if you need a second to kind of recover from him.
I just wanted to understand if a person knows a regional language and wants to help subtitle a movie for somebody else. How is that possible? Or is it?
So there are various kind of tools that we've created. And one of the most useful tools that we have is basically the annotation tool, which includes the possibility of subtitling. And this is, in fact, the biggest problem. Because the entire basis of the Encyclopedia of Indian Cinema, as well as IndianCine.ma, is that it's dependent on a search. And the search is dependent on subtitles, right? So you'll find that a lot of things can be found, and you find interesting contrasts. For example, if you go on this on IndianCine.ma and look for, let's say, I don't know, give me an example, like Tommy. You will find instances of the dog, you will find instances of the gun, you will find instances of the perfume in the various ways in which they come through cinema. So you're also creating a new way of navigating across films, but that's dependent on the subtitle. And the biggest problem that we've had for a long time is regional cinema without subtitles. So if you're interested in this, I'll let you know about how we do it. It's a very, very easy tool that you have in which you can use to subtitle.
Same language subtitling For this purpose, I mean, eventually, same language subtitling is really the most important thing. I mean, which currently doesn't really exist in Indian films, with her exception.
You know, the challenge for me is not so much about the plurality of languages, the number of films, etc. The biggest problem is the creation of a community. Because one of the largest communities online is basically the Open Subtitles community, right? It's basically a group of volunteers who are sitting and subtitling films and sharing the subtitles and making them available online. Now, same problem that we have about building infrastructures of the internet in India, whether it's in Wikipedia or it's in library.nu, cuts across in this case as well. And we're struggling with figuring out a way of incentivizing people to actually create subtitles, and we don't know what that model is yet. It's something that maybe the Wikimedia Foundation will also have to think about in the future.
So I read an article that in Indian cinema, we can find only oddly countable numbers of movies for children. So is there any specifications which you have done in your collections?
In terms of rating?
No, the movies. Movies made for the kids, children.
Okay. Well, we haven't, so we have a genre classification, but the idea of genre in the way that it exists in let's say Hollywood, film noir, comedy, drama, all of these collapse in Indian cinema, right? Any typical kind of Hindi film is comedy plus drama plus, you know, film noir. So we don't have a category called children's film, but it's an interesting one. It's not difficult to do at all, because it just requires a, you know, metadata in terms of just one keyword or a tag of the film to be children's film. And then you will find Hum Aapke Hain Kaun there easily. So.
I've been thinking of YouTube as an archive also, which is not really curated, but it's like the archive of the video.
YouTube is the greatest archive at the moment of the moving image, but it's also the greatest archive of quirky things. So YouTube is a curatorial project of the highest quality. If you, for example, look for cat fights in Hindi films on YouTube, there is someone who has meticulously gone, identified scenes of women fighting with women in Hindi cinema, made a list of it, made the clip, uploaded it on YouTube. But the problem, of course, with infrastructure like YouTube is its ephemerality is even more than that of celluloid film. Because the ephemerality of YouTube is the fact that you never know what happens to a video clip on YouTube. It's there one day, it's not there the next, right? So I'm a paranoid person, and I believe in downloading anything which is interesting on YouTube. I download it and I save it, because there's never a guarantee that it will be there. And thankfully, it's safe to say that 90% of us are paranoid, right? So in a way, that there is this constant kind of backup culture that happens all the time, where everyone is backing up. YouTube, because of its first leader position, because of the ways that it's kind of constantly innovated in making it more interactive, either via the comments or the annotations, has been the primary site for archiving material, but it's not the best site to do it, you know, in terms of, you know, it's not really a public infrastructure. And I think the WikiLeaks story has taught us that much, that we thought that things like PayPal or other things were relatively autonomous. They're not, you know. So I think, but to my mind, yeah, YouTube is also the best example of how technology and cinephilia coming together ensures that the law will always recognize its own limits. Because thankfully, we don't have as many lawyers as we have cinephiles, right? So you have a situation where a lot of what happens in YouTube now infuriates lawyers, but there's nothing that they can do about it. You know, at the most, send a couple of cease and desists, something else is going to come up tomorrow. And hopefully, if that becomes a pervasive culture, then the same logic starts moving into a whole range of other domains and practices. And you increasingly act as if the law doesn't really matter.
Whenever you get a film archived in traditional media, which is not electronic media as such, which has played in VCR prior to that, how you convert into the digital form of especially that type of media?
So this is a, if you're talking about celluloid film, the conversion of celluloid film into digital is both a tedious and an expensive process. And that's not something that we can do. That is something that the National Film Archive of India has to do. We are not the National Film Archive of India. So in a way, our aim is not to do the preservation of the physical copy. For us, we can only work with material that is born digital. Now, when I say digital, I don't necessarily mean the, you know, .avi or the .org or the .mp4. It can be a VCR, I mean, it can be a video cassette. It can be, so something which is, in a way, not celluloid. It can be analog, but not celluloid. Celluloid is too expensive a technology for us. We would like to partner with the National Film Archive. We would like to partner with the Film Division. We'd like to partner with all of these institutions who should be doing this job of preservation and conversion. But conversion from, let's say, things like the VCD, DVD, and cassettes is, of course, much, much, much easier and much more kind of affordable. In the long run, this, again, should not be something that is left only to the state. Ideally, the task of preservation and conserving should be with multiplicities of groups, because the entire idea that a single, you know, archive is the most efficient way of archiving is unfortunately constantly being proved untrue. So the logic or the philosophy of the archive for us is that one way of thinking about the archive was a central force, a force that pulls everything towards it. But we'd like to think of the archive simultaneously as a force that pushes outwards as well, something that disseminates, something that relies on the logic that the best mode of archiving is also through sharing or through reproduction, that that's the only guarantee that you actually have of things being archived or being preserved. So that's kind of where I think we differ from the traditional archives.
So just a preliminary question. Tell me if I'm right in assuming that an archive is not expected to make a judgment about the quality of the work itself. So then I'm a little interested in your definition of cinema itself and whether you find any cultural benefit in archiving home video, let's say. Because there's a couple of things that I'm reminded of, which is one is just a recent joke by a stand-up comedian called Louis C.K. where he says, I mean, when you're at an event or a concert, don't take a video of it, just enjoy the experience because you're never going to watch that video. So it's very unlike, and the thing that people do these days is just put it up on Facebook, like you go watch that video, right? So that's one thing I'm reminded of, and a few other technological advancements, we see platforms like Vine, right? Where they say it's just a 5-second clip, because no one can make a home video which is 30 seconds long and good, or 30 minutes long and good. So I'm wondering whether there's a cultural benefit in archiving this. Because
so for us, we feel we don't need to do that in terms of, because there's already a great archive for home videos, it's called YouTube. Right, so you'll find your cat videos to your birthday videos all on YouTube. Having said that, even as IndianCine.ma is an archive of cinema in the classical sense of the term, Padma is an archive of residue. So Padma is an archive of footage. Padma is an archive that says that a lot of the footage that has not made it into a film, especially documentary cinema, where because of the digital turn, you now have people who are shooting in ratios of 1:100. For a 1-hour film, you have 100 hours of footage. And that is very valuable footage, both from a historical perspective, as well as from, in a way, you know, kind of just purely as archival records. And Padma documents that. So we don't do home videos, but our philosophy is really about trying to think about the relationship of residue and value. Our argument is that cinema is a technology of excess. What is the excess? The excess is of meaning, right? There's always an excess in terms of things the director did not intend to shoot. In a lot of cases in cinema, standard shots that are taken of a city become the only evidence of that space once the space is transformed. There is excess in terms of literally footage, which is that if I have an interview with someone for an hour, the interview itself may be valuable for someone to listen to besides the aesthetic or the political logic of the film that I finally made, right? So there are all these kind of excesses. How do you actually bring that excess into the logic of things? The second thing to answer, to look at your question of this idea of the cat video or the home video, you know, there's a, again, a kind of a popular joke of a Japanese tourist who's in front of the Eiffel Tower, and he's rushing his family and saying, come, we need to go to the Louvre now. And his family says, but, you know, we haven't finished seeing this. And he says, don't worry, I've taken a picture, we'll go home and watch it. Right? So this is, of course, the risk of the world that we live in, which is Facebook time, right? Where the line between, in a way, kind of event and memory is entirely collapsed. What is the event and what is the memory? Is Facebook the excuse, in a way, for an event to take place? Because that's where Facebook is the perpetual present. It's where things will be archived forever. So that the birthday party is merely an excuse for that to happen. But what is interesting, I suppose, in the future, when one thinks about the relationship between film and form, is cat videos are a phenomenon whose aesthetic possibilities or whose status as a medium have not yet been explored. So Godard's next film that he wants to make is a cat video. Now, I want to see what he does with the cat video, but he's recognizing that there is a new kind of a visual language that has emerged, the language of the static web camera that I pose in front of. There's a marvelous work online called the Gillian Girls of the 21st century, right? So in the 20s and the 30s, as industrialization was taking place, you had the emergence of a new dance form, which is, you know, the chorus girls. 20 girls all in tune with each other, synchronized steps, leg up, leg down, hand up, hand down, right? Which is also about a new positioning in a way of the body in early kind of, you know, industrial cultures. There was a way in which this kind of mechanization, as it were, of the aesthetics of the body was taking place. This work captures the new phenomenon of the YouTube videos of girls who are dancing in their bedrooms privately to music and have uploaded it on YouTube. So you never see them in a group, but what the artist has done is create an orchestrated dance of all of these 20 small videos in which all of these individual videos, when come together, create in a way, as it were, the new logic of understanding a certain kind of techno-aestheticization of the body in terms of its positioning to the camera. So I think, I mean, you know, cat videos may still have a potential as artifacts of our times, but also as kind of resources that we have to creatively intervene in. No question on Borges, bichara ko bahut bura lag gaya. You have a question?
I was really intrigued by the sort of new ways of sorting that you sort of showed us briefly, which have come across because of the internet. And then later you mentioned how a lot of these films have been annotated and there's like the option of subtitling them.
Yeah.
Have you sort of come up with a way of sorting or searching which is primarily built on the annotated text which has come out of these films? And if there's something interesting there.
Yeah. Well, we can. I mean, so the thing about the annotations are, unlike Wikipedia, we decided that when talking about films, it's more useful to think about them in terms of layers rather than in terms of replacements or rather than edits. So in Wikipedia, if you make an entry, I can go there and change your edit and I replace your edit. What we have done is we've created a palimpsest logic. So you have 5 annotators sitting and annotating a film. So if you go to Padma, you'll find a very interesting example of this. Saeed Mirza's Salim Langde Pe Mat Ro. We did a workshop in the film studies department at JNU with 24 students, each of whom annotated Saeed Mirza's film, and there is Saeed Mirza's own commentary on the film, right? So there are these various layers that you can explore, and you can choose how you want to see these layers. You can either see them collectively or individually. You can read them together or read them individually. In a way, we are kind of interested also in the entire aesthetics of what the text-image relationship is, right? And this is such a pertinent question for our time, because we're constantly, in the various interfaces that we engage with, deal with the idea of the coming together of the text and the image. What kinds of new kind of configurations of knowledge are produced by these coming together of text and image? That's something that we're trying to experiment with. We don't have an answer. Sometimes it's really clunky. It's really kind of, you know, some crappy annotation, etc., that could be there. But that's very much a part of the, in a way, the becoming of this technology. The other question that you had, which is about this idea of the new logic of seeing, I think one of the most interesting things is that the internet allows us to see cinema very differently in the sense that when you look at the timeline view, you're given a synoptic overview of a thumbnail image of the entire film. And there's an entire kind of a new aesthetics that you can see. If you take, for example, a Hollywood film, you'll know that a Hollywood film is extremely rapidly cut. So it's action to action, ta 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 ta. So that when you see it as a whole, it looks like this kind of collage of colors. You contrast that, let's say, with, you know, an Antonioni, and you'll obviously find long, dark passages, right? Lyrical Antonioni emerging in this unreadable fashion as a thumbnail. Or you take a Michael Snow, and suddenly Michael Snow looks like a landscape painting, experimental film. So there's also this new way of trying to think about this. Now, classical film scholars will say, my God, you're killing film, right? Because you're putting too much information into film. Film is an aesthetic experience. It's not an informational experience. But that's a question that we need to ask ourselves. In the 21st century, with the advent of the personal computer, the laptop, the multiple screen in terms of the windows, we find that our cinematic experiences are hugely transformed. Of course, there is a great value in a certain attentive experience of cinema, an immersive experience of cinema that we've all loved. But you also find that now you can watch a film or a TV serial, minimize it, quickly check your mail, quickly send a reply, quickly update your status even as the film is running. And this is a new logic that is very much a part of the condition of cinema in the 21st century. Right? There is a way, but for me what is interesting is that this is not that new. Because if you look at some of the early theorists and writers, the radical writers of cinema, if you look at what, you know, either Serge Dany or André Breton, etc., were arguing about cinema, one of them was, how do you move away from the industrial disciplining logic of cinema? Cinema is an industrial technology. It emerges as and in a part of the history of capitalism in the way that it conditions a disciplined viewer, right? It demands a disciplined body. And there were ways in which a lot of the filmmakers, I mean the radical film theorists, were attempting to break the discipline of cinema. So they would walk randomly into theaters in the middle of films and watch them. So Godard, for example, very famously argues in Histories of the Cinema that cinema failed the 20th century. That the 20th century was a century of cinema, but it was failed by cinema because cinema sacrificed the power of the image to that of the narrative. Right? It subsumed image to the narrative, and for him, one of the attempts is to rescue it back. Now, even if we do not share his kind of, you know, slightly messianic radical impulses, the question for us is that if we were to look at this entire domain as a range of perceptive experiences that we're constantly encountering as technologies change, how are we to both position ourselves and make sense of it even as we creatively transform its own possibilities? And that's the idea of the possible worlds that Boris kind of, you know, gestures at.
Okay, in the interest of time, again, I have to be the whip master, so I want, like yesterday, a show of hands for last questions that people are dying to ask. Please remember that if you now ask a question, you stand between this group and its dinner. And also remember that Lawrence is going to be hanging around with us for another couple of hours, so there will be other opportunities to talk as well. But so I have two hands right now. Is there anybody else adding to that group? No, then two last questions.
So I think implicit in what you're saying is sort of a belief that sufficient copying is sufficient to guarantee the survival of whether movies, other media that you're describing. And of course, historically, it's a necessary condition, but it certainly hasn't been sufficient. Do you really believe it?
That sufficient copying is a mode of guaranteeing the survival of the cinema?
Do you think it'll actually work? I mean, I don't believe in anything except for celluloid safety stock.
I think, you know, it's not a phenomenon of the contemporary.
I agree.
I think if you take the entire history of archiving of cinema, it's certainly the case. There's a marvelous and a delightful sequence in Celluloid Man, the film about P.K. Nair. P.K. Nair was committed to the idea that any student of cinema should have access to the films that they watch. But of course, you could never actually have access because the films weren't there. But as the archivist of the NFAI, what he would do is that every time a foreign film was sent to him, he would first have it copied, right? And then he would, you know, surreptitiously, and you're never allowed to, because it's in violation of all laws. So at one point, there was this famous story in which is narrated in the film of how a film was sent to him from France. And he asked them, he said, you know, I really, really, really want to make, you know, a copy of this film. And they were very strict about it. And they said, no, 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 we cannot allow you to make a copy. And then they said, but we heard that you have this rare copy of one of these Satyajit Ray films which we don't have. So if you're willing to give us that film, we're willing to give you ours, right? So the famous story is that the film that went back in the French can was a copy of Satyajit Ray. Now this is simple logic. It's a preservation of film across multiple sites. Now that same logic for me here is replicated, of course, in the online world in a very interesting way because it's hugely kind of proliferates. The question is, how do you know where it is? That's one. You don't have an index in which it's available. And I think these are where the challenges of transitioning from one's personal collection to the idea of contributing to a public archive becomes crucial. Because the idea of the person collection, you know, as my friend Sebastian Lutgert says very often, is like a stamp collection. I have a great stamp collection. I go home, I look at the stamp collection, I clean it, I turn it around, I put it back in the almirah. But it's a stamp collection nonetheless, which is unavailable to the world. So the public infrastructures that we are looking at are also small steps of trying to create ways in which the plurality in terms of the reproduction of the tech, of the cinematic object can also find references in terms of where they are available, etc. Now, this is not the end, this is the beginning. Where it goes to, we have to figure out.
I guess I have more in mind the fact that whereas safety stock, modern safety stock will last a few hundred years. Mm-hmm. Current stuff, nitrate is a problem, but anything post-nitrate, you know, is as long as it's well-preserved, is okay, whereas none of our digital media are anywhere near that.
Oh, absolutely. There, I'm entirely with you. I mean, the question, the argument here is not the durability argument, which is that nitrate was flammable, whereas the digital is imperishable because it's a material. I think it's precisely because it's a material that it's much, much more perishable, which is why you have, you know, projects like the, you know, Internet Archive, etc. But there you run into the perpetual problem, which is that how on earth are you ever going to be able to do this, right? Borges, since we've neglected him for so long, has a marvelous story called Funes the Memorious, in which a Uruguayan young man called Funes has a horse riding accident and he falls and he hits his head. But unlike most accident stories where you lose your memory, Funes's memory is accentuated to the point that he can remember every single thing that happened to him, every sensation that he's felt, every food that he's had from childhood till now. So he decides that he'll reconstruct his entire life once, but realizes that to reconstruct one lifetime, you need many, many lifetimes. But this is a much larger problem than archiving Indian cinema. This is a problem of the internet and memory in the present. So,
okay.
CIS's next project.
Thank you. Second questioner has forfeited his rights to ask questions. I hope it was not me. I think I just want to end with two remarks. One, to invite all of you to please thank once again Lawrence Liang for this incredible talk. One that can be only summed up by my most favorite Hindi supervillain who said Mugambo Khushwa. And second, dinner served. And while you are having dinner, please feel free to take your plates, move around the entire CIS. There are infographics and posters and artistic exhibitions everywhere. And I'm presuming there are going to be two queues, one for food and one for people who want to talk to Lawrence. Good luck on both of them. But please join us for dinner.